seventh Sunday in ordinal time. Our Lady of Guru Knots, also known as Ola, is an inclusive Catholic faith community, open to all who walk through our doors with respect. We are also the Baltimore chapter of Dignity USA, which is dedicated to sacramental and social justice for the LGBTQ+ community and our families and friends. Our vision is to rebuild Christ's church by seeking out, inviting, accepting, accommodating an aspirational spiritual home for disenchanted, disengaged, and disaffected Catholics and all who seek God, a deeper relationship with God. All are invited to come to the table and share the Eucharistic meal with us. It is not a reward for being a good Christian, but rather food to sustain us on the journey. Our hymns are posted to my right. All the hymns are in the Great Gather books. As we celebrate the liturgical season of Ordinal Time, Mass Part hymns can be found beginning at number 157, which is the Gloria, and also the Our Father. All Mass Parts can also be found beginning in the Missalettes. Please join us in song with your own joyful voice. Now let us take a moment to pause, be silent, and place ourselves in the presence of God as we prepare for the liturgy to begin. Our celebrant this evening is Father Stahley, Con-Celebrating is our pastor, Father Risdorfer. Please stand and join in our opening hymn, number 738, number 738, In Christ There Is No East or West.
Thank you. strength is more than mind can bear. Lead us to see beyond our reach, and give us the courage to stand before your truth. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I shall make a suitable partner for him." So the Lord God formed out of the ground various wild animals and various birds of the air. And he brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Whatever the man called each of them would be its name. The man gave names to all the cattle, all the birds of the air, and all the wild animals, but none proved to be a suitable partner for the man. So the Lord God cast a deep sleep on the man, and while he was asleep, he took out one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. The Lord God then built up into a woman the rib that he had taken from the man. When he brought her to the man said, "This one at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of her man this one has been taken." That is why a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and the two of them become one flesh. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
And we'll be doing refrain two. reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, he for a little while was made lower than the angels, that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the leader of their salvation perfect through suffering. He who consecrates and those who are being consecrated all have one origin. Therefore, he is not ashamed to call them brothers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand.
In the fall of 1999, my father passed away in Philadelphia. It's hard to believe that that's 25 years ago. It was around this time of year that his condition really took a nosedive. He was struggling with lung cancer. And from about this time on through the beginning of November, the metastasis accelerated. And my father was gone by the 13th of November. Hard to believe that that was 25 years ago. Anyway, his funeral was scheduled for the next Saturday in Philadelphia at the parish church where my parents had attended for several years. So we drove up for the funeral, stayed with my mother. Our children at the time were almost 5 and just 3. Thomas was almost 5. Sarah had just had her 3rd birthday. And the funeral was going to be held at St. Albert the Great, one of the suburban parishes of Philadelphia. So the day for the funeral came, we drove over as a family, and the understanding was that we would go into the church, and I would join my mother and my sisters in the front of the church, where the urn containing my father's ashes were on the table. And this is where the family was going to be receiving the many guests who were coming for his funeral. I'm part of a large family on the other side, and it was a funeral, and lots of other family and friends were going to be coming. So when we got to the church, we kind of split up. I went in the door and went right up to the front to be with my mother and my sisters. Lisa had the children. Lisa was holding Sarah in her arms and leading Thomas by the hand. Now, when I walked into that church, being a born and bred Philadelphian, and making my way up that center aisle, I virtually did not even notice the crucifix that was hanging suspended above the altar. It was vintage Philadelphia. It was not quite 2 times life size, but it was a massive, massive crucifix. I didn't even see it. I walked right up the aisle, greeted my mother and my sisters. I was in the parish church in Philadelphia. This was second nature. Turned around and people were coming in. And as I said, Lisa had Thomas by the hand and Sarah in her arms. And I only found this out after the funeral, but they were making their way across the back of the church. And Thomas, our son, was transfixed by the crucifix. Now, I have to say, two confessions, that for several years before this, we had been attending an Episcopal church, much like this one, where if you're going to see a crucifix, it might be that size there. But this massive crucifix, and it was a writhing crucifix. Thomas was transfixed by this. He grabbed Lisa's hand and he said, who is that? What is it? Now Lisa had been doing her little religious studies with the kids. But Thomas was, and Thomas is, and still is, very, very good. You never have to ask, but Thomas is thinking all the time. And Thomas is, and Lisa tries to calm him down. She's trying to calm down Thomas. And Thomas is, he knows he's there for his grandfather's funeral. That's bad enough. But he walks in and sees this and he says, is that okay to the papa? Is that okay to the papa? And he said, oh, Thomas, no, baby, it's okay. Calm down, it's okay. Sarah hadn't said a word. She was on her, either, I think her Mickey or maybe her mom. Sarah was kind of like the character in The Simpsons, the little girl. And she was working the bottle. And so Lisa has to spend time calming Thomas down. Because he's the poor kid is just a wreck. He's not even 5, has barely begun to make a connection with his grandfather. He's gone. He sees his crucifix. And she finally gets him calmed down, and then Lisa says to Sarah, who at this point was almost entirely nonverbal. And she doesn't seem to be phased. And Lisa says, baby, are you okay? And Sarah takes the bottle out of her mouth and says, jump, Jesus, jump! Now, You're probably asking yourself, ironically, I mean, what is Steve talking about? Why is he telling this cute, silly, kind of funny story? When he has got a set of readings that he has got to dig in there, he's got to dig into that Old Testament reading. God made them male and female. And then Jesus is weighing in on adultery. Who's committing adultery? How are they committing adultery? I told that story deliberately because I wanted to fast forward to the last part of the gospel. Today's gospel, the last part, which is not really the most important part of the gospel, but it encompasses and transcends every other word of the readings we have heard. You have to go to the end of that gospel word or segment, where Jesus is welcoming the little children. Welcoming the children who see him for exactly who he is and are drawn to him like filings to a magnet because they understand the kingdom of God. It hasn't been beaten out of them yet. The rules haven't overwhelmed them yet. The biblical arguments back and forth, the law, what's right, what's wrong, who's bad, who's good, who's right, who's wrong, none of that stuff has yet taken hold of them. And what they still have, which we all have as children, is the gift of wonder, acceptance, receptivity to the goodness of God that is all around us. Very few of us can even survive to adolescence before that wonder and that receptivity and that acceptance is beaten the hell out of us. And what Jesus is saying, and this is more important than all those other words, all those theological debates, what Jesus is saying is, you want to know what the kingdom of God looks like? You want to know what it feels like? You know what? You want to know what you need to do to find it? Look at these children. Look at these children. And allow the wonder, the gratitude, the acceptance, the receptivity that you were given as your birthright, as a child of God. This is what it looks like. This is what it feels like. Learn from me. How hard is it? How hard is it to receive that lesson? Especially as we grow up in age, and the burden of human life can sometimes be overwhelming, and there's a tendency to retreat to rules, what's right and what's wrong, dividing this person against that person. How difficult it is to claim to the gift we were given. But that's what Jesus is doing. So the real message that comes to us from the book of Genesis, that shipwrecked so beautifully, is the wonder of God's creation. God created out of love. God gave us the ability to find each other out of love. Yes, it says man and woman, but it's a product of his time. Let's look past that. Let's transcend that. And Jesus is reinforcing that message by saying, you've got to care for and respect and be accountable for the love that you have. And if it breaks down, we're human beings. Those things happen. But you've got to do the best you can. That's really what this is about. But it's so easy to get caught up in the casualty, in the scholastic debates back and forth. I'm not dismissing them. I'm not saying there don't need to be rules. I'm not saying that there shouldn't be guidelines for us. Of course there should be. But they should not be allowed to cross over what we still have if we're looking for it, because it's still there. Regardless of the journey that your life has taken, regardless of the bad trips that have been laid on you, it's still there. You can still access it. Just to go back to the story that I began with, one of the reasons that story is so comforting to me is because on one of the worst days of my life, little Sarah broke me up when I heard that story. And as I've told that story, it now legend in the family. But there was humor, there was grace, there was innocence, and of course, Sarah has never stopped keeping me off guard. I mean, that's been one of her jobs in this life, and she's very, very good at it. The only other thing I remember from that funeral day is that I was the one designated to give the eulogy for my father. And three quarters of the way through the eulogy, Sarah just kind of looked at me. She just went like crazy, just crying, screaming. Either Lisa and my buddy Joe, who was her grandfather, would get her out of the church. But the message I took from that, as they were going out, I felt it coming from my father. Hey, let's read it for a landing. People get hungry. It's going to be a reception. Let's read it for a landing. But again, who does that better than children? And that child in each of us is somewhere in there. And that's the good news. That's the good news. May God bless us and keep us off guard.
Shelter here in our own land and across the world, we pray.
Lord,
we lift up to you, Lord, the prayers and concerns that we hold in our hearts, as well as the prayers that have been asked of your mother, our Lady, and undoer of knots. We pray.
Lord,
let us pray for all those who are in need of healing, especially for John Gray and Allison, his wife, for Chris Mullen, William Parrish, David Hansen, and for Helen Albert and her husband, for Ron Panetta and Michelle Grayson, Agnes and John Donahue, for Mary McDonald, Michael Gibson, Donna, Bill Payton, Danny, Harlan, Anna, and Elaine, for Denise and Tanya, Mildred Westner, Scott Dreams, and Dave Horn, for Diane and Michael Riggio, for Melissa Riggio, Quackenbush, Connie Bitello, and Diana Scales, for Natalie, Tricia Don, Mike Servin, Kathleen Quayle, and Claire Conbianco, we pray.
Lord, our prayer.
Let us raise up to God all those who have died, we pray.
Lord, our prayer.
For whom or what else shall we pray this evening?
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. For your goodness, we have this wine to offer. Through the divine word in the hands, it will become our spiritual work.
Blessed be God forever.
Lord, watch upon me. Cleanse me from my sin. Pray, my friends, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God through the might of God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands with the praise and glory of God's name for our good and the law of God's church. Please stand and say,
Father, receive these gifts which our Lord Jesus Christ has asked us to offer in his memory. May our obedient service bring us to the fullness of your redemption, and we ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Father in heaven, it is right that we should give you thanks and glory. You are the one God, living and true. Through all eternity, you live in unapproachable light. Source of life and goodness, you have created all things. To fill your creatures with every blessing, and to lead all people to the joyful vision of your light. Countless hosts of angels stand before you to do your will. They look upon your splendor, and they praise you night and day. United with them, and in the name of every creature under heaven, we too praise your glory as we say.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ has died. to your right hand. And looking forward to his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the acceptable sacrifice which brings salvation to the whole world. Father, look upon this sacrifice which you have given to your church, and by your Holy Spirit gather all who share this one bread and one cup into the one body of Christ, a living sacrifice of praise. Lord, remember those for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially George, our bishops, all the patriarchs, all the clergy, and all the people of God. Remember those who take part in this offering, those here present and all your people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember those who have died in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith is known to you alone. Father, in your mercy, grant also to us, your children, to enter into our heavenly inheritance in the company of the Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and all your apostles and saints. Then in your kingdom, free from the corruption of sin and death, we shall sing your glory with every creature, through Christ our Lord, through him, to whom you give us everything that is good. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Jesus taught us to call God our Father, and so we have the courage to sing. Thank you.
proceed. Just a quick little thing. Mike sent me a note today that said, beginning of November, that Sunday, November 3rd, is the what? First one? 32nd Sunday of Cardinal Time. However, the day, 2 days before, November 1st, as all you good Catholics will remember, is All Saints Day. One of the great feasts of the church, celebrating all of those who are in heaven. November 2nd is All Souls Day, where we remember all about our loved ones who have gone before us, as it says in the Mass, set the mark of the sign of it. So their idea was, Ordinal old times or Ordinal times, we might have a chance to move up either for Souls Day or All Saints Day. And Steve and I were talking, and it's our moms next to us, but we think it's a good idea to have one of them. So who would like us to celebrate? First of all, it's okay if you celebrate something other than the 39th Sunday of Ordinal. All Saints, All Souls, All Saints, All Saints. So two, All Souls. The souls have it. By the way, Father Stephen was celebrating that Sunday and was on the ball. And I was referring to that off the ball for these readings that we got to make. So, fantastic. Jump, Jesus, jump! Can we honor our blessed Lord?
Also, one more quick note. Next week, we are in the church hall.
Yes.
So, there's a concert happening in the sanctuary next week, so we'll be over there. If we can get some people to come early and help us set up, and then also be prepared to turn down.
Also on December 13th, there's another one. So, we knew that's going to be a conversation about this.
And also, October 26th, 40 West, that will host a walk-a-thon. So it's going to be in the Easy Park from 10 a.m. to noon. Not 10 p.m. So. You can see the flyer on that table right there.
Okay.
Please join us this evening for our Marian hymn this evening, number 790 in the Gather Book, Immaculate Mary. Again, that's number 790.
Heal the minds of every Russian leader and soldier so that they might see God.
Our Lady, Queen of Peace, and the doer of us.
Pray for us.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Again, that's number 603.